In the previous video, we started our discussion of the different PV technologies. We discussed the abundance of the elements used for crystalline silicon and the record efficiencies. Now, let's continue with the thin film technologies. Thin film solar cells are made from films that are much thinner than the wafers that form the base for the first generation photovoltaics and therefore use much less material. The processing techniques used for thin film solar cells are very different from the techniques used for crystalline silicon. Thin film solar cells were expected to become much cheaper than the first generation solar cells. However, due to the current price decline in the wafer-based solar cell, most thin film solar cells have not yet become economically viable. Please know that all the concepts and technology we introduce here will be discussed extensively later in the course. We will start with the thin film silicon. Rather than the crystalline silicon structure of the first generation PV technology, thin film silicon has an amorphous structure. These amorphous silicon solar cells use many of the same materials as crystalline silicon. Additionally, hydrogen is used for the passivation of the amorphous structure and zinc is used for the transparent conductive oxide layer, or called TCO layer. Another class of thin film solar cells are the chalcogenide solar cells. The term chalcogenides refers to all chemical compounds consisting of at least one chalcogen anion from group 6 and at least one or more electropositive elements. The chalcogenides are a very large group, and in this course we will focus on the two most important technologies. First is cadmium telluride, which currently is the thin film technology with the lowest demonstrated cost per watt peak. This class of chalcogenides uses materials from group 2 and group 6, and also elements like aluminium, zinc and oxygen for the TCO layer. The second group of chalcogenide solar cells are the chalcopyrites solar cells, which consist of the elements from group 1, 3 and 6. Foremost among these are the copper indium gallium diselenide solar cells, or CIGS for short. So how about the elemental abundance of these technologies? Thin film silicon makes use of the same elements as crystalline silicon, with the addition of zinc, which is a major industrial metal, and hydrogen, the most abundant element in the universe. As we can see, thin film silicon uses no rare or toxic elements. Next is cadmium telluride. While the supporting materials like sulfur, aluminium, and zinc are abundant, cadmium telluride are not. Telluride is even among the rarest stable solid elements, with an abundance of about one atom per billion silicon atoms. This is comparable to the abundance of platinum. Furthermore, elementary cadmium is toxic, and it's very important to prevent cadmium entering into our ecosystem. CIGS faces similar issues. Copper and gallium are major industrial metals, but indium, selenide and cadmium are much less abundant. In addition, the current thin film display industry depends on indium as well. Because of the scarcity and toxicity of the required elements, the upscaling of the chalcogenide PV technologies might be limited. The efficiency of these thin film technologies has increased steadily over the last couple of decades. The performance of CIGS and cadmium telluride solar cells is very similar, with a record efficiency of 22.6 for the CIGS solar cells from ZSW and 22.1% for the cadmium telluride solar cell from First Solar. The performance of thin film silicon solar cells is lower, with a stabilized record efficiency of 14%. The addition of the stabilized term will be explained later in this course. Next, we discuss the 3-5 technologies. As you will learn later in this course, this type of PV technology is mainly used in multi-junction configurations, in which multiple 3-5 alloys are used. The 3-5 alloys are based on group 3 elements with three valence electrons like aluminium, gallium or indium. And group 5 elements with 5 valence electrons like phosphorus and arsenic. As some of the 3-5 concepts use a crystalline germanium wafer as substrate, it might not be considered as a real thin film PV technology. However, the 3-5 based absorber layers can be considered as thin compared to the thickness of the crystalline silicon wafers. If you look at the elemental abundance of the 3-5 technologies, we see that only aluminium and phosphor are really abundant. Gallium, arsenic and germanium are not rare or precious metals, but they are much less abundant than silicon. Indium, as we discussed earlier, is rare and in high demand. Gallium arsenide, therefore, is a very expensive material. Moreover, arsenic is a highly toxic, and it's strongly suggested that gallium arsenide is carcinogenic for humans. So why do researchers still pursue these 3-5 technologies? Let's take a look at the record efficiencies. Of all the thin film technology, the 3-5 technology results in the highest conversion efficiencies under both AM1.5 standard test conditions and concentrated sun conditions. The current record solar cell by Fraunhofer ESE has a conversion efficiency of 46%. Consequently, the expensive high-performance 3-5 PV technology is mainly used in space applications and concentrator photovoltaics. Finally, we will consider organic PV technologies. For organic PV, the used absorber materials are either conductive organic polymers or carbon-based organic molecules. In the organic PV section, we will also discuss hybrid organic inorganic PV technologies such as the disensitized solar cells and the perovskites. A wide variety of materials are used for organic PV from different groups. Generally speaking, even though organic solar cells themselves use cheap, abundant materials like carbon, they require expensive encapsulation materials and contacts to protect the organic materials from humidity, moisture, and air. Some of these materials, like platinum, ruthenium, and iodine, are very rare. This constraint limits the industrial application of organic PV. Let's look at the record cell efficiencies again. We can see that apart from disensitized solar cells, the organic PV research has only been going on for the last decade and a half. In that time, organic solar cells have reached a record efficiency of 11.5% by Hong Kong USD, and Sharp has reached a record efficiency of 11.9% for disensitized solar cells. Perovskite solar cells have reached an impressive efficiency of 22%, but not yet achieved a stable efficiency. That concludes this introduction into different PV technologies. During this course, you will gain an in-depth understanding of the various module architectures, manufacturing and processing methods, and advantages and limitations of each of these technologies.